I went to do a Q&A after a screening at the Jacob Burns Center with Janet Maslin. Mm-hmm. And I showed Janet the movie maybe 6 months ago, mm-hmm. and she really liked it, and she had really interesting stuff to say about it. And then later she was like, I want to do a Q&A with this after the thing. So I arrive at what should have been 10 minutes before the end of the movie. Mm. And I kind of go in, I look at it, and I'm like, oh, yeah, that's weird. It's definitely 25 minutes before the end of the movie. Mm. They must have started late. So I'm not really thinking about it. So then I go in and I see Janet, and I said, well, how did you like it the second time? Now the credits are running eventually. Mm. I said, how did you like it the second time? And she said, oh, it was really interesting. You changed it a lot. And I was like, so I'm thinking like, well, she's getting a little bit older. Maybe I should do that thing where you're like, yeah, we made a few changes, so you're not totally rude. But I was like, no, she's smart. I'm like, no, I didn't change it at all. This is exactly the same thing you said. I saw last time. She's like, nope, no. And I was like, really? She goes, yeah, that whole thing with the bulletin board. I'm like, the bulletin board hasn't been in the movie for a year and a half.
Oh my God.
The bulletin board was in some cut I like fought with Harvey over. This is insane. And then she mentioned two or three other things that are not in the movie. But there's no way she would have known them if she hadn't just seen the movie. So I'm like in a panic. I start texting immediately. But now it's like the audience is like, thanks for coming. And I'm walking on the stage. I'm just like, I'm like, we have an emergency situation. We just put one of our new prints at the Jacob Burns Center, and it's definitely not a new print. Mm-hmm. And I figured out, we did a half an hour Q&A that was mm-hmm. insane. It was really funny. Mm-hmm. And it was literally like me just saying, the woman would say, well, what do you think about the bulletin board and why did it? And I would say, I don't know what movie you just saw. I have no idea. I'm really confused. Right now, my mind is kind of a blank. I want to help you with that. And then at some point, it became really pathetic. Like, they started saying things like, well, let's just say in the version that you did, you know, how did you deal with the information on the bulletin board? I'm like, this is so hypothetical now. I really can't have this conversation. And, of course, we found out that Technicolor, which is closing in L.A., mm-hmm. had just super fucked up on this, basically this one print.
Right. Thank God.
That had never been shown to press. It had been mm-hmm. shown to two audiences, like, in New York that obviously thought it was fine because I didn't even get a phone call about it. But it's what we used to call the Frankenstein cut, because when I was fighting with Harvey over the cut, he said, well, what if we tried this? And at a certain point, I just said, sure, try it, we'll test it. Mm-hmm. So he put together the craziest version of the movie ever, and we tested it, and our version of the movie, tested them back to back, and our version of the movie did great, and his version of the movie got killed at every level. It got killed for mm-hmm. clarity, it got killed for entertainment value. It was just wrong. And but somehow there had been a print made to screen at some point. It was in the Technicolor vault. And they just, to save money, they said, well, these three reels, we could just use these three reels instead of reprinting them. And so the movie that had been made had final titles on it, which is what totally confused me.
Right.
And yet it was a cut that I never made.
It was the Harvey and the Machine.
Yeah. And Janet, of course, was like, I bet you.
Conspiracy.
It was a conspiracy. And I called her later and I was like, this is what happened. But,
I went to see Red Violin at a theater in town, like a regular paid movie theater. And there was something wrong. And I kind of knew enough about looking for the cigarette burn that still was there back in those days to say, you know, to figure out that there was something, they had actually reversed reels. Mm. And this had been playing. Red Violin was a very popular movie and very respected movie, and been playing this way at an art house in town for months. And I went to the manager and I'm like, you have reels 4 and 5 reversed. He's like, nobody's ever said anything before, that can't be. And argued with me for a good half an hour. And I think they finally figured out that it was the case, because it was like, there were so many time jumps in the movie, they didn't know.
Mike Nichols told me that, I told him the Technicolor story, and he explained to me that Technicolor on a movie, he didn't tell me what movie, but it was a big movie. It wasn't The Graduate, but it was something like mm-hmm. a pretty big movie. And he said that they sent the movie out to 1,000 theaters with the soundtrack from Reel 2 repeated on Reel 5.
Oh my God.
And that they also never changed it. Mm-hmm. They said they were going to swap them out, but most of the projectionists never bothered to swap them out. So the movie just played with like people's mouths moving and bizarre. Sound and music and the wrong place.
And nobody said anything. That's the amazing thing. Audiences don't notice these things.
I showed capturing the Friedmans at MIT, uh-huh. You know, Massachusetts Institute of Technology. So I'm thinking, oh, this is going to be some super high-tech projection or something like that. And I get there, and there's this, like, teenage kid who's obviously, like, in the math program, and he's running this projector. And I watched the movie. Marcel Ophuls was there. A few, like, really, like, great filmmakers, people I really wanted to see the movie the right way. And I'm watching the movie, and it's too fast. And I'm like, it was substantially too fast. People are just starting to talk a little too quickly, and Elaine Friedman's a little whinier than she usually is, and everything was just weird. And I said to the projectionist, the movie's too fast. Oh, no, it's impossible. The way the projector is calibrated, I said, look, it's too fast, I'm telling you. Well, there's no way for me to control it. It's impossible, sir. I mean, I understand you've probably seen the movie too many times. It's too fast. So I get to the end of the movie, and I go up there, and I say, well, it's, you know, 9:15. How long is that movie anyway? He says, oh, it's 106 minutes or whatever. I said, yeah. Did it strike you that it played in 100 minutes? Well, yeah. I said, you remember when I told you what time it was when it started? Mm-hmm. Yeah. I said, so the movie was 6 minutes too fast. I said, do you know how fast the movie has to be to end 6 minutes early? And the guy's like, well, actually, I said, let me ask you, have you had other filmmakers who've been surprised the movie's ended more quickly than they thought? He said, well, yeah, we've heard that a few times.
Oh, God. MIT calibration.
It's incredible.
So it's been 7 years since that screening. It's a long time between babies. Is that just the way it is? Is that just you were waiting to do this? And then, of course, the last drama of the year and a half. But even then, it was still going to be a 5-year difference between your first and your second.
Yeah, I think, first of all, I think it takes me a long time to make a movie. It took about 5 years to make Capturing the Friedmans. Mm-hmm. And we did make another movie in the meantime, this movie Catfish, which in one way or another took about a year, but it was sort of a break in the action. And it was I didn't direct that movie, so it was a chance to just sort of come at it from a different direction. But this movie has taken a long time to gel. You know, partly because we're taking this 30-year story and distilling it, and, you know, the movie's, it has a lot of material, and it has to be presented in a way that's going to be compressed, I think, for the audience. But it was, you know, it was an incredible experience.
So is that the biggest challenge on a story like this, is figuring out how to compress it?
I think compressing is really important. I also think that when we first started out, taking an interest in the story of Robert Durst and the remarkable history of this case and series of cases, we didn't really think about the way that it's normally done. And we didn't think, well, we're going to go and have some quick approach to this. We just thought, well, everybody that's written about this has written about it poorly. And all the television shows that have done little tabloid stories about this have kind of turned it into this burlesque story, but the real story is a really deep, interesting human story. So let's go back and talk to all the original people. Maybe we got that from our documentary experience, but it just seemed like the only way to do it. So we ended up doing a year and a half of interviews with people. We did 100 interviews with incredible people, you know, people in the government, people in the police force, people that knew the couple. And
this being a documentary was not an option ever for you?
I never thought about it as a documentary just because, you know, there's so many unanswered questions and things have been so investigated and over-investigated. But to me, the interesting thing was going to be to bring actors to it and to try to sort of fill in the gaps in the story in a human way by figuring out how the story would play out, you know, without having to make it clinical. So we went out and just did these interviews thinking, A, we're going to get fascinating stories, which we're then going to be able to build into the screenplay, which we did. Things that you couldn't make up, you know, the story about, you know, when the Frank Langella's character takes the little tiny wedding party out for lunch, and then he makes the poor mother split the check with him. You know, that was a true story. That was something we never could have written. And it's really extraordinary, and it gives you, in a very compressed way, a really clear sense of what that kind of person is like. And so we did a lot of that to develop the story. And then at the same time, we thought, well, whatever we're doing now, we've got to distill this into something that the actors can watch, so mm-hmm. that the actors have something really strong to draw from. Mm-hmm. And while we were doing all the work, sort of documentary style, going out mm-hmm. and getting all this information, I talked to people in Hollywood who would, you know, who were sort of annoyed that it was taking us a long time, and they would say, you know, this isn't how it works in Hollywood. You know, all you have to do is just have to go find an article, and then mm-hmm. you buy the article, and then you just use that as your research. And I said, but I don't trust any of that stuff, and I would need to do it myself. And the articles seemed kind of stupid. And they said, no, I know, but the audience won't know the difference. And, you know, for me, I've never really been doing this to make a movie quickly. I've just been doing it to have the experience. And it was such an incredible experience to go out and talk to these people. So I think when the movie comes out, there's probably a nostalgia about that too, that you love the movie, and I'm really proud of the movie, but at the same time, you sort of watch the movie on screen, you watch all the people seeing it, and you sort of feel like, wow, remember the good old days when we were just talking to people and discovering this stuff, you know?
Is that a studio voice, or is that an agency voice, or who's whispering in your ear, faster, yeah, Hollywood?
I think almost everybody, you know, I think...
But I mean, is it somebody who has an investment who's trying to get to the end of their investment place?
An economic investment, but there were a lot of people. You know, whenever you have a really a movie that's this sort of becomes, it gets a lot of attention, like Capturing the Friedmans did. Everybody immediately says, "Well, I want to represent you, or I want to work with you, or I want to do the next thing, or I want to write this thing with you." And unfortunately, there's no substance to that, because if you don't have the next thing. Mm-hmm. Nobody's going to hand it to you. And also I think the process of developing a movie has to happen in a vacuum. And I don't know. I've never read a script and thought, that's for me, you know. Maybe just because it doesn't feel intrinsically like it came from me. But I'm not opposed to the idea. But certainly what happens is when you start working on a movie and it takes you a while, you end up having people who say, you know, is this ever going to happen? Mm. And maybe your whole working style is just not really going to reach fruition in some way. And
you and Kubrick.
From your lips.
Well, but I mean, it's an interesting thing. I mean, has it ever been a consideration for you? I mean, or for your brothers for that matter? I mean, you guys have become like, you launched an empire of Jareckis on the film business.
Well, you know, my brother Eugene, who I talk to a lot, and I think is really an extraordinary filmmaker. He and I talk a lot about this kind of obsessional thing. My father is like that. My father is somebody who has literally millions of pages of documents from his whole business career, and before that he was a professor at Yale, and he has all of his files from that. And he will go back to his files from 10 years ago to find a letter. Mm-hmm. He'll see a typo in the letter. He'll circle it, make a change, and send it out to his typist. Mm-hmm. And I say, why are you doing that? Well, it's a mistake. Mm-hmm. This letter has already been sent, and nobody who you sent it to is even alive anymore. I don't like it being out there with a mistake in it. I'm like that. I know it's insane. My brother's like that, Eugene. Mm-hmm. You just, you know, you become very, I think, compulsive about knowing that the record is right and mm-hmm. knowing that you've done the most work you could do. And I'll give an example of when this really matters is about, you know, 4 or 5 months ago, Jesse Friedman had a lawyer who was appealing his case based on the information in Capturing the Friedmans. Mm-hmm. And they did a huge amount of work for free because mm-hmm. Jesse has no money. And we helped them in a number of ways, and they took it to the Nassau County Court, and they were rejected. Mm-hmm. They eventually got it up to the Second Circuit, which is just below the court of below the Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. And they got the Second Circuit to write a 10-page opinion saying that they weren't going to accept their rationale, but mm-hmm. they wanted to let the Nassau County District Attorney know that they thought this case was a travesty and that it needed to be reexamined. Mm-hmm. Nassau County District Attorney agreed with them and agreed to reopen the Friedman case based on the film. It was, for me, incredibly gratifying to see the film meet reality in that way, mm-hmm. and suddenly it could have an impact. And so over the last 4 or 5 days, the district attorneys asked me to put together material and stuff that I thought would be interesting in their process of reinvestigating the case. Mm-hmm. And I went back into my files, and I have thousands of documents about it. You know, kids I interviewed who were in Israel, kids I interviewed who were in, you know, Maine or in Washington State, people had scattered to the four winds, but people that we had found, that we had, you know, sought out. And that stuff is going to be important. You know, the research from this film from 7 years ago, from 8 years ago.
Well, the fact that they're still actually dealing with courts and 6-7 years later.
Yeah, yeah.
It's kind of
amazing.
Remarkable.
Yeah. That's why it was fascinating to watch. There was this piece in the New York Times where Charles Bagley, who's a really interesting writer for the New York Times, who's actually the real estate writer, we thought he would be a great guy to write the Arts and Leisure piece on All Good Things because he really has a sense of those big real estate families in New York and how it works in these like wealthy Jewish families that control huge swaths of land. And he had once said to me, I met him a long time ago because when we first started working on the movie, I wanted to talk to him. And he said to me, unless you understand the relationship between the top 4 or 5 real estate developers in New York and the mayor's office, you don't understand how New York works. And it really was an insight for the film. I started to realize how powerful the Durst family was in New York and how important Seymour Durst was, the character that's sort of played by Frank Langella. And it was so perfect then that 5 years later, he writes this piece. And among other things, he calls Robert Durst. And he has access to Robert because he's spoken to him before. And ever since we started working on this movie, I've said to my partners, I want us to, the conscience of the movie here is we've got to be fair to everybody. And I want this to be a movie that Robert Durst can watch and have an emotional reaction to. We started saying that the first day. And this piece came out in the New York Times, you know, last Sunday. And he spoke to Robert Durst. And Robert Durst said, I like the movie very much. I thought it was by far the most accurate thing that's ever been done. And I cried when I watched it.
Is there anything personal about, I mean, besides all the work for you in the film?
Well, you know, I come from a you know, very wealthy family in New York with a large family business, and I have a very strong-willed father who absolutely wanted me to be in the family business. And, you know, I think for these guys, it's, you know, it's understandable. They work their entire lives, they build this big enterprise, and they think, well, this is obviously incredibly hard to achieve. Why would my son want to do anything other than carry on this family business? It's hard enough to build a business, let alone, well, I'm going to build one, and then my son's going to say, I don't want to do it. You know, that's a pretty big luxury. But the reality is I didn't want to do it, and we struggled over that and talked a lot about it, and ultimately I did certain things that my dad wanted me to do and certain things that he didn't want me to do. I've always seen Robert Durst as a character and a person who struggled with a lot of those same things, with, you know, what is your legacy and what are you trying to do and how do you be yourself within the context of this incredibly made bed. So I think it was personal for me in that way. You know, I graduated from Princeton in 1985. I was getting ready to go to Yale Drama School for directing because I had directed theater. And my father sort of came to Princeton to visit me for the first time probably, and you know, he's not much of a visitor. You know, he's a very engaged, interesting person to have in your life, but he generally doesn't come and see your school play or something like that. And, you know, I remember him really sitting down with me and saying, I hear this whole Yale Drama School thing. That's interesting. Let me tell you how artists deal with the world now. What happens is they have a grand vision of what they want to do, and then they go out to try to do it. And they end up talking to somebody with money, and the person with money says, well, this is how I'd like you to do it. So that's the situation you're going to be in. Alternatively, you can come into business, learn something about it for a couple of years, and then you're not going to get bamboozled by all the business people. It's a very compelling argument. And if you look at Frank's character, Frank Langella's character in the movie, he is an unbelievably persuasive guy. You know, he goes up to Vermont, connects with Kirsten, Ryan's wife, and realizes that maybe the quickest way to get to his son is through her. He starts manipulating her, developing a relationship with her. Ryan shows up, and it's almost like he caught them in bed together.
Yeah.
So, you know, I've seen that certainly in my life, the way that people, you know, they want you to do a certain thing, and they want to, and they use a lot of really, you know, really complicated tools to get there.
So it seems the big difference between this guy and you and Eugene is that you guys have created a legacy for yourselves in the world. It's not necessarily your dad's legacy, but it's you guys have already, in just a few films, taken a position that actually seems to matter and has some real
influence. Well, it's nice of you to say that. I mean, I think, you know, I was just watching my brother's, the first cut of my brother's film on Reagan. He's doing a really, I think, sort of the seminal piece on Reagan. Mm-hmm. And he's doing it in time for the 100th year anniversary of Reagan's birth. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's got an attitude that's not that different than the stuff that I work on. You know, mm-hmm. we both are probably pretty agnostic. We don't like doctrine and feeling like, you know, there's some easy answer to something. So it's easy for Eugene, who I think is generally perceived as kind of a liberal filmmaker. It's easy for him, you know, he can make a movie about war, right, and really give you some insight into it. But I think there are a lot of hawks who would say, well, you know, that movie was a very liberal movie. Mm-hmm. Making a movie about Reagan turned out to be, I think, a big challenge, because Reagan is an incredibly interesting guy. Yes, it's true that he is part buffoon and part, mm-hmm. you know, ultimately sort of doddering in his older years and so on. But he was also one of the most interesting and hardworking and thoughtful presidents, and carefully developed his career. And so you watch a film like that and you can see both sides. And that's always what's interesting to me, is to try to, you know, paint a picture that's not black or white.
You can't really dig into all the information and not come out with some sort of gray, yeah, and some sort of appreciation for what the motivation was, yeah, for your character.
But I think some people will see All Good Things and say, couldn't you just make it simpler for me? I just want to know who killed everybody, right, and what's wrong with them. And I've heard that from people, mm-hmm, who said, you know, maybe you should just have a psychiatrist who sort of explains to us what it is exactly. Or, and I had the same thing with Capturing the Friedmans. People, mm-hmm, said, what you should have in that movie, this is what the movie needs, mm-hmm, is an expert on child molestation and pedophilia. You know, you could shoot me, and I would be happier than if you put an expert, yeah, in my movie. It's not what the movie is about. The movie, yeah, was an emotional journey. It was not going to be a clinical, mm-hmm, exploration. So, I don't know. To me, obviously, the ambiguity fascinates me, whether it's ambiguity about what happened or just ambiguity about who someone is. That's the stuff of it. And so you get moviegoers who will go see a movie like this and say, I love that you left a lot of it up to me, mm-hmm, that I could sort of have my own opinions about this. And other people who say, you know, when I go to the movies, I just want to sit back and have you tell me what happened. And
shouldn't be going to this movie. They should go see, you know, Unstoppable. Because that, you know exactly what's going to happen. It's funny, though, with Errol Morris, for instance, on Fog of War, he got very angry at me at one point, which he does almost every time we talk at some moment in the conversation, but that the idea that it was ambiguous in any way. Like, he felt he was very anti-McNamara, and no matter how much, you know, people saw that movie and kind of thought it was sympathetic to McNamara, though it certainly didn't make him look like a good guy, that idea really pissed him off.
You know, Errol Morris is a brilliant, brilliant filmmaker, and I'm sort of a huge fan of his movies, and yet I can tell right off the bat that we're diametrically opposed to each other in our, mm-hmm, approach, because he invented the Interrotron, yeah, and to me, Interrotron has the word interrogate in, mm-hmm, in it, which I think is exactly what I don't do, and right, God love him for doing it. And I also think that the thing it's designed to do, which is to put you in a different room from your subject, mm-hmm, is the opposite of what I'm trying to do. I'm always thinking about, I wonder if there's a way that I could get rid of the matte box so I could get my face right up against the lens, because I want the subject to feel that we're having a conversation, and I want to feel we're having a conversation. So as soon as you put a mirror in front of the camera and you go into the other room, it's kind of genius, right? I mean, it's an amazing idea,
yeah,
and it works really well in certain movies like, you know, Gates of Heaven or whatever. Mm-hmm. You know, these movies where you want the subject looking right into the camera, mm-hmm, it becomes this weird, strange document when that happens. There's, mm-hmm, something great about it. On the other hand, I don't want to objectify the subject in that same way. I, right, want the subject to be with me, you know. I don't want to say, well, look, this is perfect, I can sit in another room, you know, or I can, mm-hmm, sit in my trailer and direct the movie or something like that. To me, I'm sitting on an apple box in front of the camera underneath the kitchen drawer while Kirsten and Ryan are doing their thing, because I want to be right there. Because I can't remember what director said this, but somebody said, I keep shooting until something happens. And I think that's, I really believe in that. I believe that these moments that are real between the actors are what the audience really thrives on. Audiences are inherently narcissistic. You know, we go to the movies because we want to see ourselves. We want to see, oh, that's interesting. I had an experience like that once, and I had a girlfriend, and let me see how they played it. And so when you make it real for them and you have all the quirkiness and the oddity of real life, which is a lot of, in all good things, what these scenes are like is, you know, they have a tremendous amount of real detail because of how we constructed the movie to begin with. I think people respond to that emotionally. And there are moments between Ryan and Kirsten and you know, where something really unexpected happens, and that's the moment that the movie really takes off. And you see it in a scene, you know, whatever's going on. You know, Frank and Kirsten are doing that scene on the porch, and I know what that's like. You know, my father met my first girlfriend. My father was kind of a strapping, you know, guy that saw himself as very attractive, and women liked him and all that. And suddenly he meets my girlfriend, and there's kind of a vibe there. It's an older guy, and sort of a breath of fresh air in the house, and there's sort of this knowledge that your son is kind of in there, and that's all sort of weird and incestuous and interesting. That happens in this scene between Frank and Kirsten because there's a flirtation going on of some kind. You know, there's a real Frank Langella, who's really a high testosterone guy, and there's this beautiful sprite, Kirsten, who's up on a ladder, and they're talking, and, you know, that situation is charged automatically. And then, you know, Ryan's about to show up and sort of catch them in the act of talking. But, you know, I know what that guy's thinking. He's thinking, yeah, if this young lady really knew what she was doing, she'd know a man like, you know, I could satisfy her in a way. I'm sure my son doesn't know what anything, you know, what to do with something as lovely as this. And, you know, there's a certain egotism in that character that comes across in the real interaction even between the actors.
Yeah.
So that's always, you know, real to me. I feel.
And in your script, he's not afraid to tell his son exactly that.
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
So do you, were you a actor, would you consider yourself an actor's director coming out of Yale?
You know, well, when I was in Princeton, I spent a lot of time,
brain damage.
I spent a lot of time, in theater thinking about actors. I think that, actors are, you know, more than essential. For me, they're sort of the fun part because otherwise, you know, it's boring to go in there with all your own ideas. You sort of want to go in there and say, look, these are my ideas. I'm barely holding them all in my head. I have 100 of them. But they might be totally irrelevant. I want to see what you're going to do with this. And then when they, if they work really hard and run out of gas on an idea, I feel like it's my job to be like a second brain for them and to say, well, what if that's not true? You know, what if he just said that to you and it's actually not true at all? Well, no, I was playing it like, you know, I believe him because he comes in and he says the thing. And you say, well, that's interesting, but you think it's possible he could be lying? Yeah, it's possible he's lying. Let's try it like that. And that just, I think, gives them the next thing to chew on, and then that conversation suddenly becomes real in a different way. And also, I will often talk to one actor without the other, and often you have to take them both aside because it's kind of weird. You isolate one actor if you just keep talking to the other actor. Sometimes that's appropriate. You know, sometimes sometimes you do want the other actor to be a little bit out of water. But you know, that's not that my goal is not to sort of manipulate them. But there are certainly so many times when you're in a conversation with somebody in real life and you know something that they don't know. Why should it not be that way in acting? You know, you should be able to say to the to Kirsten, listen, you're thinking about leaving tonight at 9 o'clock and never coming back. That's what you're, oh no, you can say to Ryan, listen, the night that you go see your father, you're thinking about killing him. That changes everything. Now the whole, you know, and by the way, Frank's reaction to that is he's nervous. And I haven't told Frank that's what's happening. Right. And then later I remember telling Frank, you know, well, this is sort of what I told Ryan in that scene. And he said, well, I don't know what you told him, but I was worried, you know.
Well, Ryan and Frank generally are considered more challenging actors in terms of they really are more strong participants, I guess, in the work with the directors and the writers, and they do have a very strong position on sets. Kirsten is not known for that necessarily. Was that the case ultimately when you worked on this film?
I would say that the way it works in life, which is that women don't seem like they're in power and then suddenly they are. Mm-hmm. Kirsten is a great example of that. You know, she knows exactly what she wants. She also is willing to experiment, which mm-hmm. I think is very hard for a lot of male actors to do because, mm-hmm. you know, we naturally, as men, we kind of feel like we should know what we're doing and we should come into a situation and take charge of it. And Kirsten's not like that because mm-hmm. she has this sort of female approach, and yet she's so bright that she'll come in with a pretty clear idea of what she wants to do. Mm. I don't think in any way that she's no shrinking violet. You know, she knows how to play a character that's more dominant or more submissive, or mm-hmm. but she always brings an interesting idea. There's a scene in the movie, a whole section in the movie, where she has an abortion, and it's really antithetical to who she is. You know, she's mm-hmm. this Irish Catholic girl raised in this modest family in Long Island, and, you know, she ought to be marrying somebody fantastic and having three kids or five kids, you mm-hmm. know, and obviously she's sort of set up for that. And she finds herself in this strange marriage to Ryan's character, which is a little different than what she expected, but she's mm-hmm. crazy about him. And when things go wrong, suddenly she is in some way forced to have this abortion. Mm-hmm. And it's heartbreaking for her, and I think it's heartbreaking for the audience. And for the longest time, we were sort of struggling over that. If she's going to do this terrible thing, mm-hmm. how is the audience going to love her the way that we need to love her? We're seeing her succumb to a manipulation that will result in the death of her child. Mm-hmm. How do we see that as something positive? How do we connect with her after that's happened? Mm-hmm. It was bothering her a lot. And she came to rehearsal one day and she said, I think I understand this now. She said, I think that the decision to have an abortion for me is a decision to protect my unborn child. That I know that my husband is not stable. Mm-hmm. That I know that it's not healthy to bring a child into that situation. I'm at risk, and I don't want to bring somebody else into a risky situation. I'll put my desires to have a child on hold, and this time will end the pregnancy. Mm-hmm. As a result, when you see her in the cab and she's going to have the abortion, she's doing it with absolute conviction. And mm-hmm. even the next morning, you know, when the scene before she goes to have the abortion, she's looking at herself in the mirror and she's putting these earrings on. It's an elegant scene. It's mm-hmm. sort of a funeral scene, but it's not some milquetoast girl that's been pushed into it by her husband. It's a girl who's made a decision to do something awful for the mm-hmm. right reasons. That was something that Kirsten came with on her own. I couldn't have come up with that. Mm-hmm. It's the kind of thing that a woman can think through. So to go in there and have her bring that to me was such a gift. And mm-hmm. I think, you know, to some extent, when people say, are you an actor's director? I think what that really means is, are you a good listener? And are you willing to accept incredibly valuable donations constantly from the people that are your partners? You know, mm-hmm. you have to be.
Though her power, her strength through the whole film is really, or through her part of the film, is critical to Ryan's weakness. I mean, that's the, it really has, you almost need that kind of performance to balance out what he's doing.
Yeah. Yeah, and when you think about it, I mean, I think she's extraordinary talent. And, you know, when we first started working on the script, we knew that we wanted her to do it. And again, we heard this sort of Hollywood thing, which was, you know, you got to lock in the guy before you mm-hmm. get the girl. And we knew that we wanted Ryan to play this part, and we were in a discussion, and he had read the script. But, you know, he hadn't committed to the movie, and we wanted to show it to Kirsten, so against a lot of advice that you should always wait, because what if the male mm-hmm. actor doesn't like the girl? What if he doesn't think she can do it, or what if mm-hmm. it puts him off in some way? We just said, look, anybody that doesn't understand why Kirsten is right for this part probably shouldn't be playing the other part. So mm-hmm. we offered it to her, and it just happened like that. She read it. She said, mm-hmm. "I'm in." She liked other stuff that I had worked on, and you know, mm-hmm. she said, yeah, we'll meet, that's great, but this is good stuff, I want to do this. Mm-hmm. You know, and then we got together, and it was like the first meeting was just talking. She came to our office in New York, where we just have tons of stuff about the case and newspaper articles and clippings and junk all over the place. And you know, we showed her this little documentary that we had made with all the interviews strung out, and we were immediately working on the movie.
Which will be on your DVD, or won't be on your DVD?
I think it will be. I was just talking to somebody about that those interviews have to be on the DVD.
So you jumped in. You're running out to get could go end up with another shoot and then an airplane, but we didn't get to talk about Catfish or your life with Harvey, which seems to be like it could be another hour.
Life with Harvey. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. You know, Harvey's still an executive producer on this movie. They're selling foreign on the movie. And, you know, he and I get along well. I think we sort of, there's a general mutual respect there, you know. I'm always impressed by what he's able to do. And, you know, whether we're really good working partners or not, I don't know. You know, it's this movie had its own mind. And in some way, I think I was trying to decode it. And it was going to take a while to do that. And, you know, now I love the movie, and I think you know, he wrote me a note the other day when there was a great review in Rolling Stone, and you know, he wrote me this nice email just saying like, I'm thrilled about the review in Rolling Stone. That's terrific. So you know, we went through some back and forth, but ultimately I think we get along.
He's an interesting character because he does. I always say he's with the Harvey Scissorham things happen. It's usually, if a film is not working, he's actually the best person in the world to recut it. And if the film is working, the filmmaker's actually in control, probably the worst person in the world to cut it. And I think that ends up playing out in this situation.
Yeah, I mean, I think in fairness to Harvey, he gave me a lot of notes on this movie. And sometimes my reaction was that gut reaction where you say, you know, his solution, which is, you know, you should have a piece of ADR here that clarifies this thing for the audience. I seldom agreed with the solution, but I would always come back a couple days later and I'd think, that thing he mentioned is a problem. You know, and we'd end up sitting in the edit room and coming up with a solution. And to his credit, if you bring him a solution, even if it's not the solution that he proposed, he says, all right, well, great, you fixed it.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's kind of gratifying because it's hard. When you get the movie to a certain point where it's working, people tend to get lazy and they tend to say, well, look, it's working. Look at the performances. And they take their hands off. And I'm not like that. I'm like, oh, there's something about that scene and the phone call takes too long and it doesn't feel right. And he's like that. You know, he'll say, look, yeah, the movie's working and the audience liked it and all that stuff. Let's do more. You know, we've got to keep making it better. And, you know, I'm still not sure if I understand this or that. Or, you know, there's whole things you can do that are not in the movie right now. There were actually the scenes in the movie where, you know, there's a search at one point of the lake in front of the couple's house, and we had shot a lot of stuff, you know, frogmen diving off of boats, and it was really interesting stuff, but it wasn't ultimately needed in the movie. And he said, yeah, but it's good stuff to have. You should find a place for it. And I remember thinking, like, that's totally ridiculous, you know, you can't. But then in the end, we found a way that Ryan would be sitting in Galveston, Texas, watching television, and suddenly that footage would come up as footage that was shot back in Westchester County at the time of the disappearance or later when they started to reinvestigate the case. It's kind of great. It sort of like gives you a little perspective into it, you know?
Right.
And, you know, I was talking to J.J. Abrams, who always helps me a lot with stories, and he said to me, you know, when we were doing, you know, Alias, we shot this unbelievable set piece with this giant set. We spent, you know, 40% of the budget on this one incredible sequence, and it didn't fit ultimately, but we took just a piece of that footage and we made it part of another scene, and it just made this window open up in the movie, and you think, oh my God, behind the scenes there's this huge machine going on. So you know, when you shoot the stuff, you can often find a place for it that maybe expands the frame of reference for the movie.
The genius of Corman, back in the day, who made something out of nothing all the time.
Yeah,
but that's I think creativity and, you know, work process is probably the thing that the media covers the least well. And because most of us don't really have any sense of what it is at all, much less really understanding it and being on a set for, you know, all those days, all those hours, all those years. But it's always fascinating. And I think Harvey is misunderstood for that reason. I think a lot of what he does is what's done publicly and not what's done behind the scenes. People don't really know. And I think it's true with, you know, most filmmakers, is you don't really know how these things come together.
Yeah, I think that people are nervous about admitting that they don't know what's going on. And I think that the filmmakers that I think are the most interesting are the ones who say, I don't know how human beings work, but look what happened. Look at this amazing scene, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think that's a, you know, that's a sign of maturity. I think it's something I always am trying to find, you know, is the ability to just accept that reality is more interesting than the stuff that we make up. And that's probably why I keep getting drawn to these real stories, because, you know, these little quirks and oddities of human beings are the thing that most defines us, you know, as creatures. It doesn't make sense to me. That's what's interesting, you know.
Yeah. It's all in the margins.
Yeah. I mean, that's when we were doing Capturing the Friedmans, when we did the DVD, we sort of had, we gave it a name. We called it Outside the Frame. We were just saying, whatever's in the frame is this big. Mm-hmm. The stuff that's outside the frame is millions of times as big. And so, you know, that's why we followed people around with cameras and we went to Q&As about the movie. And it's why I love that in the New York Times, Bob Durst is saying, I loved the movie and I cried. Mm-hmm. That's so interesting because it tells you that the movie in some ways transcended the plot. He may disagree with elements of the plot,
right,
but disagreeing with the plot is very different than saying those relationships made sense for me. I was there and those things happened, you know. Yeah. That's gratifying.
And in the end, he felt something, which is really what it's all about, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. I also think that a lot of filmmakers want to, maybe it's this context, like people, mm-hmm. they go and they do interviews about their films and they want to have like talking points and they want to make sure they say certain things. And it's hard to go into conversations about your movie and not feel like you have to know everything. You know, you want to be able to say, oh, let me explain that to you. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I've been doing these sort of Q&As about the movie recently, and there's a moment in the movie where somebody opens a door, and we don't know exactly what's behind the door. Mm-hmm. And an audience member at this DGA screening said, you know, well, I was confused. I want to know what was behind the door. And I said, I know. And the audience really appreciated that as the answer. And then 5 minutes later, a guy at the other side of the auditorium said, no, you didn't answer the question from before about what's behind the door. And the audience went crazy. Like, they turned to the guy and they're like, yes, he did. He did answer it. We don't want to know. Don't answer that. So that was great for me because I just feel like, you know, you don't need to go into these things saying to the audience like, well, I know, but I'm not going to share it with you. I don't know. You know, do I know exactly what happened in the Friedman house? No. Do I know what happened in Bob Durst's relationship with his wife? No. But did we do a lot of work and get close enough to make him cry? Yeah, we did. I don't know how that happened, but we worked really hard at it, and ultimately something came together. Alchemy more than planning.
It's a good thing. Thank you.